right, and away we go. Pumping up the bubble. Pumping up the bubble. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is called pumping up the bubble when we say this over and over and over. The bubble is what we call the presence of truth emerging into this realm of waking sleep. Four realms: reality, deep sleep, sleep, waking sleep. And our day-to-day activities is waking sleep, which is the deepest level of forgetfulness of what we are. And this bubble from reality, we're trying to get it to emerge into waking sleep. That's the challenge that we have. And we can imagine it like there's a, what do they call those, jump stations for kids they have to inflate it with air, right? And they have a machine they turn on and it gradually inflates it with air. Like a huge, you know, balloon. And so this bubble is like a big balloon that we have to inflate. And we inflate this balloon by this bubble. We're inflating this bubble by saying, I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And just continually, the more we say that, the more we're inflating this bubble so that it can actually appear in waking sleep, which will be quite a marvel for everyone, because most of the people in this world are completely unaware that this is possible. And certainly hardly anyone is used to it at all. And but it's extremely helpful. It helps us get the wow back to where it needs to be. We cannot be short of enlightenment. We cannot be without the wow. We're going to be craving a wow factor somewhere. And the big trouble with this world is right now is that this cosmic corporate culture is diverting the wow onto where it shouldn't be, off of enlightenment, off of realization, onto things, images, people, bodies, trivialities, all this, you know. Wow, I just got a like on my video. I just got a tweet, or I just tweeted. Wow, you know, that kind of thing. It's a misplacement of the wow. This is the huge trouble. I call it the Antichrist, that which is displacing the wow and subverting religion as much as possible. It's already been subverted to a large extent and lost its steam. And so people are still searching for the wow, right? They're missing something, which is what? They're missing the experience of their true nature, perfect freedom. As we're trying to insist that there's a problem with reality, we are not experiencing reality the way it really is. We're experiencing it as if there were some problem with it, even though there isn't. We're just imagining that there's this problem. There really isn't. So we're not experiencing our true nature. We feel deprived. We're desperate to get this. To be recognized, to feel some entitlement and recognition that's our true nature has, sovereign actually over all experiencing. And so we need this wow factor, like something that we just say, wow, this really reminds me, or this feels like I'm getting recognition now. So we cannot escape this desire. And so it's all important where. What direction do we turn this desire in? Is it towards the lives of the saints, those who've awakened to their true nature and stopped pretending there's a problem with reality? Or is it to those who claim there is a problem with reality and we're busy fixing it, or we're trying to adapt to it? You know, like, wow, here's a new adaptation. Here's a way you can be happy even in this new reality, which is problematical. Wow. So, this is the great struggle that's going on in the world right now. The diversion of the wow, which many have fallen prey to now, actually. So we're putting the wow back where it needs to be, and we're working on helping others with that as much as possible. I have tried to do that my whole life, not had much success, because this is during the whole rollout of the, well, it's one thing after the other. It really has been one thing after the other, nonstop. First the Beatles came on the scene, you know, and before them there was the, you know, the really sophisticated studio music, and various things gradually grabbed our attention. Then came the drugs. Drugs grabbed people's attention, and the drugs got even more intense when the cocaine came along. That was a very, very intense situation. It got into disco music, and there was just a ton of drugs in involved in that, and on and on and on and on, people's attention. Then came, you know, computers. And now it's, you know, smartphones, and now it's, you know, just everything else the internet came along, smartphones come along, and it keeps pulling people into this misplaced wow. So here I am saying, hey, you know, spend your time studying the lives of the saints. That's where the real wow is. That's where your wow should be, because you should be looking at that and saying, wow, that's what I really want. And I need to get used to this. I need to get used to this. I've forgotten what it is. So as long as people's attention keeps getting captured by these fake wows, by the Antichrist, by this false religion, it doesn't seem to do much of any good to tell people, well, what, you know, study the life of this saint, you know, pay attention to this Ramana Maharshi, for instance, you know, there's a wow for you right there. People keep having their, you know, their imagination fired up by advertising, gadgets, and this whole false religion that has gripped the world. Very much a false religion. But when we actually are present with this, with the truth of our being, which is that reality doesn't have any problem at all, this definitely produces a wow, can produce a wow in many people here. Yeah, but it has to be that potent to offset the extreme efforts of the false religion to grip our imagination and attention. It really has to be right here, right now, in everybody's face, so they can, you know, otherwise it's not good enough. So this is what we're directly working on. And I've been working on this all day today. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And if you can, I started about 5 in the morning, woke up early, and I just started it. I've been keeping it going. It's now 2:30 in the afternoon, and I'm still doing it. And so if we can focus on this a little bit. It's interesting, because as we're doing this, all sorts of thoughts come up, many of them saying, hey, I think I'm getting it, this is really helping me now, I think I need to now, I'm just about ready to be enlightened, I need to focus on the finer points of this enlightenment, and then you stop doing it and you start thinking. So much of the distraction is positive distraction, saying, great, this is working so great. This is working so fantastic. I'm just about here now. So now I need to start thinking about what to do next. And then you stop. So I would suggest just continuing it no matter what arises. Because one thing's for sure, if enlightenment really is about to occur, saying this, I am not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me, that's certainly not going to hinder it in any way. So the idea that somehow you have to stop that and start thinking in another, you know, to prepare or do something else, as if saying this is going to stop, block you from enlightenment, is ridiculous. It's just completely absurd. But it seems to be very compelling when we say, hey, this has worked so well, now I'm just ready now, so I better stop it. And there's a counter, the world is trying to counter this by deflating the bubble. There's an effort to deflate it. So when the air, so to speak, is being deflated out of that, you hear this other little saying. And little songs will arise in my mind that try to distract me. What's that one? Stars linger, stars fade, but I linger on, dear. Still craving your, kiss. I long, da, da. That song by the Mamas and Papas. Dream a little dream of me. Dream a little dream of me. That keeps trying to reassert itself. As soon as I stop saying I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, this song, Dream a Little Dream of Me, immediately it arises. And this is an attempt to deflate the bubble. Okay, deflate the bubble. It's totally egoic. It's totally based on, bodily attraction, attraction to the world, attraction to time, space, process, and form, and everything that speaks of a problematical reality to us. So that mantra arises. So this mantra is within us. You see, this deflation is within us. And when you try to inflate the bubble, there's this deflation. You realize this deflation tries to grab a hold of you. And you just have to just go right back. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And the mind will the deflation tricks will do all sorts of stuff to get you to stop. Very ingenious techniques. This is why we have such trouble. There's so few bubble people arise in this world. Bubbles from reality, from the truth of reality, which is there isn't any problem with reality at all. They rarely arise here because of the deflation efforts are so intense. We are trying everything we possibly can to keep supporting the notion that reality does have a problem. This is what we're used to. We've been overemphasizing this and overlearning it, and over-repeating it, and believing this for so long. For so much effort has gone into this with no detail overlooked, that we feel, we have imagined something that can never be unimagined. And so this is why we have to keep repeating, inflating the bubble into waking sleep is not so easy. The efforts at deflation are very ingrained within us, very ingrained and very clever, very sly. And it's just like seems like second nature to us that we just slip right into this and just poof, deflate. So that's why when you may get a little bit of a bubble going here and you start feeling like a little bit of getting close to enlightenment, glimpsing it, feeling like I'm real near, that it seems to deflate away from you. It deflates away, and it does. This it is deflating away. That's what's happening. You feel like you're losing air and just poof. The jump station is just sagging, and the kids can't jump anymore because the basketball's all deflated, and try to bounce it and just poof, just kind of sits on the floor, doesn't it? So we're pumping up the bubble here. Pump up the bubble. And there's that little song. See, it jumps in. As soon as it's playing in the background, I have to say, I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. So, waking sleep is this condition of extreme deflation, the deflation of forgetfulness of what we are. And so, it just acts as a deflating activity. Action, it's like deflating dynamic that just keeps any remembrance out of waking sleep. Now, in sleep, we have all these distractions too that are also very good at distracting, and yet they're not quite as successful. So it's much more likely that you'll have these dreams of enlightenment. And all sorts of dreams of knowledge, and then in deep sleep you have even more So it's the waking, this waking sleep, that provides the strongest barrier. That little mantra that keeps popping up, still craving your kiss, is that you know, that song. That's, oh, still craving your kiss. It means that flesh is still craving the flesh, you know, still craving the problematical, the kiss of death, the kiss of problematical reality. It says it's still craving that, craving. I'm still craving that. You see, this is the attitude of this world. This is the attitude of waking sleep, very strongly. And you just have to ignore that and just keep saying, I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. And just keep doing this. So if you're game for that, that's the way to go. Don't get too overly involved in trying to inflate it with thinking, because there's too much deflation in thinking inherently. So the words that you're using, it's easy to, you know what I'm talking about. Whereas if you say, I am not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, I am not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, there's very little deflation taking place there in asserting this. Very little. Which is what we want. Which is what we want. Whereas if we're trying to figure it out and thinking, well, I wonder what I'm doing wrong. I just can't seem to understand it. And I wonder if this... You know, there's a lot of deflation inherently in that. Words are confounded, levels are construed of the meaning, and the ego takes an oppositional position to it, and you have to argue with that and try to untangle that, and it doesn't have enough juice to bubble up into waking sleep. So that's why these affirmations are used, these assertions. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And as we do this, this bubble starts coming into waking sleep, and this is why we start experiencing, oh, wow. I say, oh, wow, it's possible. And this is stunning to us because the whole premise of this waking sleep is that it's not possible, that reality has a problem. The reality has a problem. This is the basic premise of our delusion, self-delusion, that reality has a problem. Which is not true at all. No truth to whatsoever. And yet we're pretending as if reality does have a problem. It's kind of like sometimes kids get another kid in trouble. Like they're feeling restless and mischievous, which many people in this world are full of mischief, and they want to get their friend in trouble or someone they don't like, and they're irritated and they're bored or whatever. So they'll stir up some trouble. So. They'll like be pushing the other person and the stuff's going on, and then suddenly they'll go, ow, ow, you're like, ow, and you know what happened, and he's like, oh God, you know, it's just he hit me, you know, and and then the guy will get in trouble, no, I didn't hit him, well, you know, the one that's screaming, oh, he hit me, you know, is pretending that they got hit, But in our case, though, our pretending is so great that a severe bruise will form. Look at the bruise, you know. There's the evidence and stuff. But our mind is actually producing all this evidence. It's just an appearance, trying to claim that, you know, God hit us. In other words, that there's a problem with reality. So we can pretend like there's a problem, and it seems to show up. We seem to say, look at this problem. Look, we're dying. We're this. But it's only all in our mind. We're simply imagining all this to be able to claim that the reality has a problem, so we can claim that then our awareness of this problem makes us superior to God, prime creator. But nobody's really hitting us. You know, it's just mischief. We're engaged in mischief. We're engaged in whimsicality, whimsical mischief. This is the root of our troubles. And we've become so wrapped up in all this mischief that we continue on with mischief, even thinking that there's good mischief and bad mischief, and dividing it that way, and saying, well, we're deflating the bubble this way, and that's good. good mischief, and then those over there are deflating in another way, and that's that they're bad. That's bad mischief, you know. And so we make these arbitrary divisions over mischief and whimsicality, as if avoiding one is all that it takes, and being subjected to the other isn't a problem, which is nonsense. It's nonsense. Any belief in that reality has a problem is delusional. So the good and the bad fighting one another are both delusional, equally delusional. You know, the good is saying this bad is this really bad problem with reality, and so I have a good problem, and that is I have to stand up and protect reality and defeat the bad problem. You know, so reality isn't safe until I defeat this this terrible darkness that's trying to destroy it. That's a problem with reality, and so we hear this that reality isn't safe until the good defeats the bad, kind of thing. Well, that means that reality has a problem, right? Right now, it's not safe. This is the delusion. So the good is claiming that they're only acting in the interests of reality and its best interests by defeating the so-called bad. And they'll say, well, the bad is really a severe problem for reality, but once I defeat it, you know, it won't be anymore. This is the division into good and bad, and thinking that we need to put our attention onto that, which we don't, because that is the delusion right there. There is no problem with reality. Reality has no issue of being fearing for its safety. It needs no champion. It needs no hero. It doesn't need anything to be defeated. The whole notion that there's a problem that needs to be defeated, that we're the good people and we're out there to defeat it, that is the self-delusion. That is the deflation that belief keeps reality in our from keeps us from being aware of the truth of reality. So we're so busy in waking sleep trying to be good, trying to defeat the bad, trying to get rid of the evil, that we don't realize that this itself is preventing the awareness of reality to bubble up into our awareness and to our attention. That's what's preventing it. So the good are, you might say, they're the most deluded of all. Those who are claiming to be good, that they're you know, trying to destroy the bad, that they're the avenging angels of God out to get rid of the bad. That's the deepest delusion of all. That hides it more than anything. So I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And this other troublesome mantra keeps going, which is trying to deflate and saying, oh, we love existence. We love this problematical situation. We crave for more of it, you know. I said, that's what the world is claiming. Displaced wow is what this is coming from. Displaced wow, putting the wow into the world, to worldly things, bodies, people, circumstances, situations, things, materiality. That's a displacement of the wow, which is the false religion. So the false religion is trying to assert itself in the mind here, and I'm trying to bubble it away, you know, provide a bubble here where it can't, it just bounces off the bubble. And so even though it's still going on, people are able to say, hey, wait a minute, you know, it's not going on with that in that bubble there. I see a bubble that's different. So I'm not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And you will find that it's difficult to keep doing this. The mind wants to wander off and it starts falling into deflation. Now, I thought it was so difficult here. I thought maybe we just all just sleep all the time and just stay in the sleep. But that doesn't work out so good either, because how do you function? Because certainly in the sleep, there's a lot more awareness. It's easier to get that awareness there. But we want to bring it all the way into waking sleep here. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now these videos are recording, they can record up to 4 megabytes and then they automatically stop. I don't know how to get around that, but that's what we have happening. At least it's more reliable so far than the other ways, which have proved to be quite unreliable. So it's interesting, become aware that there's this underlying deflation, siren song you can call it, a siren song of deflation into maintaining your allegiance to problem, the imaginary problematic existence. That we still crave it. No, we don't. What we crave is recognition of what we are. That's what we crave, but you'll never get that recognition through this world, through this waking sleep state. Never get it that way. You'll never get it by placing the wow on bodies and process and time and space process form. That will never provide the recognition that we really crave, which is that we're free. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. That's the recognition that we're craving. So you never get it through a kiss. You know, you never get it through a kiss, in other words, of this world. That's symbolic of trying to get recognition. Like, wow, you know, wow, someone really likes me. Got a kiss. Of course, they're craving recognition from you, and it's this mutual craving of recognition of your personality, your person, your body, and all of that. And it never's enough. It's never sufficient. So it's never a true relationship. It doesn't work. It's a special relationship designed to generate recognition that we crave, the wow factor we really crave. And when this bubble arises in waking sleep, that carries with it a very strong wow factor that resonates with our true nature, and then that's when we begin to turn away from bodies and special relationships and say, wow, that they don't have what I'm looking for, but this does. Historically, in congregation, males and females were kept separate. Why? To minimize any wow factor between them, to minimize the special relationship, which we're so addicted to searching for the wow recognition within the special relationship. And the purpose of congregating to remember God is to remind ourselves where the real wow factor is, when putting our wow factor in the right place, putting our attention there. And this is where we'll get the recognition. So it's very important that that people are not being pulled back into special relationship wow. You know, that they're so addicted to misplacing the wow that it's easy for them to do that. It's absolutely easy. That's why there's supposed to be dress codes in for instance, church or temple or mosque or ashram or whatever. It's supposed to be very strict dress codes. And it's best that genders are separate, and because they're not there to what they're there for is to set down the wow factor between bodies, okay, and put the wow factor where it belongs, okay, on enlightenment, on realization, on our true nature, on problem-free reality, flawless reality. So you see, there's great wisdom to these various helpful situations in the world. Minimize the attraction to bodies. Minimize the attraction to bodies. Minimize the special relationship. You're never going to find it there. You're only going to find bitter disappointment and blame and despair and arrogance and all sorts of all the troubles that, you know, operas are full of, that soap operas are full of, all entertainment is full of, all that nonsense. It's a waste of time. We must put aside this craving. The craving we have, we can't put it aside. We just have to put it put it where it belongs, which is we're craving for our true nature, our flawless, perfect nature. But how are we going to have that craving satisfied when we are believing that reality is flawed? So what we're trying to do is we're trying to satisfy the craving for our perfect nature, which through something that we believe is flawed, that's not perfect. You can't do that. You can't get there that way. It's impossible. We'll always feel like there's something wrong, something missing, and blame the other person or blame ourselves. In the special relationship, we're lost in severe delusion. And this world here is obsessed with the special relationship now, so obsessed with bodies. This is the false religion. Very much false religion. And they're under the guise of all sorts of social agendas, etc., that, you know, being just and fair and right and everything, that everybody should be able to pursue special relationships wherever they want to. And, you know, it's not fair that we cannot have as many special relationships as we want, and on and on and on and on and on. This is the false religion in the world. This is the Antichrist in the world. And we should be making it, you know, more and more difficult for there to be special relationships, de-emphasizing it more and more and more and more, and then since the craving to experience our true nature, we cannot get rid of it, we then have to have a resurgence of spiritual practice, which is to focus on in the right direction for where that craving can be finally satisfied. There's no way around any of this. There's no way around. The idea there's some utopia without any of this is nonsense. Total nonsense. Until we actually experience our true nature as totally problem-free, is totally problem-free, the craving remains. And as long as we keep projecting that craving onto our imagined scenario of imperfection, reality as imperfect, therefore meaning that we're now bodies, not spirit, and etc., etc., as long as we keep doing that, we will continue to suffer, and be, suffer spiritual dementia, severe forgetfulness, and great frustration and misery and death and on and on and on. That's it. There's no way around it. So we have to be spiritually reoriented towards where is this wow factor? Where do I really need to focus on? You know, not some celebrity or beautiful body or celebrity or something. Some person says, "Wow, look at look at that person," or "I'm attracted to this person like that." No. Be attracted to realization. Be attracted to clarity. Be attracted to truth. Have your wow be aligned with clarity, where you start seeing more and more, wow, I really can experience my true nature. My true nature really is problem-free. Wow, this is all just a dream. Wow. And you start to see that this craving will finally be quenched. The thirst will finally be quenched. It's like we have this terrible thirst in the way that must be quenched. And the only way to quench it is to experience reality as it is, which is problem-free. And the attempts to quench it by experiencing through what our imagined problematical reality is problematical, trying to quench it through this imagined scenario, will never quench the thirst. We still have a burning thirst, and then we keep drinking more and more and more. So people go in that direction. They want more and more bodies, more and more bodies, you know, more and more relationships, special relationships. It just, the thirst cannot be quenched. They turn to drugs, they turn to everything they possibly can to try and quench that thirst. But they have the wow misplaced. They take as a basic premise that reality is problematical, and then they say, okay, I have this terrible thirst, so I have to quench it within this problematical reality. So how do I do that? And this is their basic question. This is a wrong question. This is a wrong question. It's a mistaken question. Based on a false premise. The premise is, they say, well, we know that reality is not perfect, so how do we quench this thirst in this imperfect reality? And the answer is, reality is perfect. And this so-called imperfection is only our desire to try to prove that we're greater than God by imagining that reality has a problem and insisting it does, even though it doesn't. So, and our thirst can never be quenched there. So the way to quench our thirst is to accept reality doesn't have a problem. That's the way. It's the only way. It's the only way. We keep thinking there's some other way. There isn't. There's only one way. There's only one way, and that is accepting that reality doesn't have a problem. Now, we've done a lot of foolish stuff trying to solve it in some other way. A lot of foolish stuff. You know, for instance, we're so... The special relationship is so frustrating to all of us here because we say, you know, we got to quench this thirst, but I'm still thirsty. And then we blame the other, saying, you're not giving me what I want. You're the reason why I'm not, this thirst is not being quenched. And they say, no, you're the reason. And so we have all these battles going on in this world in many, many ways. And then some mischievous smart aleck came up with this idea, like, hey, you know, let's use this... let's use this theme of the scapegoat, and we'll say that neither one of us has the problem. It's the scapegoat that has the problem. It's that one that's producing the problem in both of us. So we'll claim that the problem is there in the scapegoat, and then we will kill the scapegoat, and then our problem is gone. This is how mischievous mentality has figured out, like they think this is the answer, using a scapegoat. So in other words, two people are fighting with each other, they're hating on each other, say, you can't quench my thirst, you promised to quench my thirst, and then another says, no, you're the problem, you're not quenching my thirst, and then they say, hey, wait a minute, you know, we're going to fight forever like this, you know, this is terrible, so what do we do? Hey, they say, hey, you know what, it's that person over there that's casting a spell on both of us, causing us to be angry and upset, and they're the problem. They're the problem. And so two get together and agree that one over there is the problem. And that one there is then the scapegoat of the situation. Then they both decide to attack the scapegoat. So this eventually becomes codified into religion of sacrifice. That something has to be sacrificed. Something has to be destroyed. That something that carries the enmity in it is destroyed. And, you know, in other words, put all the sins onto of the world, meaning the failure to quench your desire, your craving. Put that on the scapegoat. Sacrifice the scapegoat. And they say, okay, now you are now both free of this problem. This is magical thinking, magical belief. It's ancient. It's been going on for so long, this sort of such belief. Sacrificial atonement is an ancient pagan belief, actually, that of those who don't know the way. the way, again, is to recognize reality doesn't have any problems at all. We've simply been trying to project a problem on a reality, which doesn't make it real. And we've done this by asking for experiencing from reality, asking for an experiencing we don't really want. And then when reality gives it to us, we say, hey, wait a minute, I didn't ask for that. You distorted it. You see? And so this is what we've been doing. And then we can claim, well, reality obviously has a problem. It's not able to give me what I want. it's just very mischievous, isn't it? And so, again, sacrificial atonement doesn't work. It's a magical solution, obviously, because still, the craving hasn't been quenched at all. It's just temporarily we think we have some hope, like, okay. But that's why they have to keep the sacrifice going and keep believing in it. You know, you keep saying, okay, every day we have to remember that the sacrifice has already been made and remind ourselves, yes, and renew our magic every day. Otherwise, the enmity starts bubbling up again. Very interesting stuff. Very interesting stuff. It's very interesting how this plays into history and religious history and stuff. The Sanhedrin, for instance, in Judea, was constantly sacrificial atonement. Well, the Sanhedrin and the Temple of Jerusalem was wiped out by the Romans. I can't remember the date exactly, but it was completely decimated, and the sacrifices stopped. The temple was destroyed. But what took place there was that the Jewish belief in Jesus as a perpetual sacrificial atonement, perpetual sacrificial victim that was renewed continuously through ritual. So since they didn't actually have the priests sacrificing animals, sacrifice continuously, and people going and paying them, and you know, having this, that ended. But they said, well, that's okay. It's okay because we have a sacrificial atonement that is perpetual, one sacrifice that continues on and on and on and on as long as we keep the ritual of recognition of accepting that fact going, that sort of thing. But it's still the belief in sacrificial atonement. It's just that they couldn't do it anymore in the temple. Romans destroyed the temple. This is, you know, very, very interesting stuff, as historically speaking. But, you know, how is that changing one's mind about sacrifice, the ineffectiveness of that, of saying, well, we have a perpetual sacrifice, and so we don't have to keep doing it over and over, but because we don't have the temple. The temple was supposed to be the only place in the world where sacrifice was effective. This is the problem that the Jewish people had, was they had convinced themselves that the Temple Mount was the only place, and the Sanhedrin were the only people, and the chief priests, you know, basically the ones who did the sacrifice, that was the only place, the only people, the only way possible to bring about this relief from God and get rid of this feeling of sin, this inner craving that's not being satisfied. That's the only way it could ever happen. So they had a big problem when the temple was destroyed. Big problem. But lo and behold, here was the solution with Jesus, of saying that this was one sacrifice that was good for all time, so to speak, and didn't need to be repeated, you know. So they could sort of transfer their, what was the Pharisees, I think, was the, could kind of Now, what happened was it went into rabbiism instead of sacrifice. Rabbiism, they could say, "Hey, look at this. We still have a sacrifice, but it's a perpetual sacrifice, and all you have to do is believe in that, and that will get rid of this inner thirst that is bothering you. But you have to continually keep believing in it, or it'll come back on you." It's better to know this. It's better to know this than to not know it. It's better to know this. Because the real solution is not sacrifice at all. It's the recognition that the reality has no problem. This is what the true realizers realize, that everything is perfect. Everything is absolutely flawless. Where all experience is pure experience. We are getting exactly what we asked for. So there's no problem with reality at all. We're just asking for, in a spirit of mischief, asking for what we don't want, so we can then claim that we didn't get what we wanted. So nobody has to be sacrificed. You don't have to blame anybody for your thirst not being quenched. It's our own fault. It's not someone else's fault. It's our own belief that's causing that, believing that reality has a problem. So the solution, as John the Baptist said to the true Christians, repent, 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 for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, what could very well have happened is, it's hard to say exactly what happened back then, but the I believe it was that the Sadducees was the Sanhedrin were doing the sacrifice, I believe, and the Pharisees were the ones who ultimately survived the Roman pogroms against that area, and they were very keen on trying to say to the Romans, "Hey, we're the good guys, you know, we're the good guys." And this way they could say to the Romans, "No, we're no longer believing that we need to reestablish the Jewish state and the temple and the sacrifice. We're now, you know, rabbinical, the powers and the rabbis, and we have this perpetual sacrifice. We don't need to repeat it." And then they had it so it fit in with the Roman belief system and was able to survive and integrate sort of within the Roman Empire. And then it became Roman Catholicism, which, you know, Rome sort of adopted it as its own eventually. But, you know, exactly, you know, what the early Christians really believed, you know, is another question, isn't it? And of course, Jesus knew all along that he was going to be leaving here. He kept telling the apostles, "Look, I'm only with you for a short time," and he kept telling them, "Well, you know, I'm I must go. I'm going to go through this, and then I'm out of here, and it's better for you if I'm not here." So that was all prearranged. But what exactly happened, and why, and all of this is an interesting, certainly interesting. And has it been, you know, was it expropriated? Was it expropriated by the rabbis who wanted to make nice with Rome? And to, you know, was the whole thing written in such a way as to appeal to Roman sensibilities? Actually, a lot of people are saying, you know, that's looking at it carefully. It's like, wow, pretty interesting. Fortunately, we have Jesus' words today, which he says, "If you really want to succeed, say, 'I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me.'" So if the crucifixion took place, let's say that it did, maybe the purpose that Jesus had for it was quite different than what we're told by through Roman Empire, you know, its appropriation of it. It's adoption of all this. They may have spun it the way that they wanted to have it. There's many other explanations other than a sacrificial atonement, many other explanations that could be, that are much more. I cannot ever even remotely imagine Jesus believing in sacrificial atonement. In fact, when Jesus has come back now in this day and age, for instance, in A Course in Miracles, Jesus is absolutely adamant that sacrificial atonement is false, completely false. It's a magical belief system, and he seems to be, you know, intent on dispelling this mistake and falsity. So there's no way that we could twist that to say that is what Jesus' intent was, is to promote the belief in sacrificial atonement. That's utterly contradictory to what he's saying now. And if he was enlightened back then, which every indication is that he was, then it's absolutely impossible that he could be truly teaching a different doctrine than now. You see, the two, that doesn't add up. And you'd have to then say, well, the doctrine he's teaching now is completely mistaken, and the doctrine back then was a sacrificial atonement. But then you'd have to disbelieve everything that he's saying now, which, if you look carefully what he's saying now, you know, how do you disbelieve it and at the same time believe in reason at all? You really can't. You have to throw reason out the window and believe in magic. Which is, magic is what? The belief that we can quench our thirst in a problematical reality. That's magic. And this is what all the pagans have believed in from time immemorial. So it's much more likely that the pagans adopted this situation, scenario, and put their own spin on it. Okay, I think that's what the historical record is showing more and more. They put their magical spin on it. So I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the words of Jesus saying that there's never been any problem with reality. There's never been any problem with reality. In fact, we cannot produce a problem. It's impossible to produce an actual problem. Now, all these things represent problems, actually, because we think that they're violating the laws of reality, meaning somehow they're self-existent and have duration, this time, space, process, and form. That somehow they're the way we perceive everything seems to be violating reality, but we're misperceiving it. So how can we call misperception perception? It's a denial of seeing clearly. It's not real seeing at all. Everything is already equally abiding in pure spaciousness. There's no difference among anything whatsoever. This is the great sameness of everything. Everything has this total sameness right now. And seeing that, that's seeing reality. And this is something that the great teachers have pointed out. For instance, Longchenpa, seeing the sameness, the great sameness, the matrix of this vast, imperishable, perfect sameness. That's the vision. That's the vision of reality. Perfect sameness. There's no problem with that. There's no problem with pure spaciousness. You cannot say that there's something that is not perfectly abiding in pure spaciousness. Therefore, it's not separate. There's nothing separate from pure spaciousness. You cannot say that. You cannot say there's something that somehow is here and pure spaciousness is there. You cannot say that there's this subjective, objective nature to everything in terms of God, of ground, of being. This is all mistaken. This is all our delusion. So we're saying we certainly will not get the quench our thirst through magic. Okay, through magical belief, through sacrificial atonement, through scapegoating, through saying, hey, the reason why we're not quenching our thirst is that one over there. See, the idea of putting all the sins of the world on Jesus, meaning all our furious enmity towards, animosity towards one another, because we're not, you know, fulfilling the promises we made to one another to quench each other's thirst. We put all that animosity onto Jesus and saying, you know, it's Jesus' fault. It's all Jesus' fault. He's the one that is causing all this trouble. And then by killing Jesus, we think that this trouble, mischief, dies with him. But we have it backwards. Jesus isn't. That's like saying the reason why we can't quench our thirst through a belief in problematical existence is because reality is perfect. So the way to cure our problem is to kill the perfection of reality, and then so we say magically then we'll be able to quench our thirst because we won't be craving perfect reality anymore. That's gone, and then all this, you know, physicality, all this fleshness, that will satisfy us then. This is what we believe. So we believe by sacrificing Jesus, we're really killing reality. Okay. And that the perfection of reality is no more. So we think, okay, it's gone. It's done. Perfection of reality is no longer done. Jesus has been crucified and dead. And that means that this problematical reality, this imperfect reality, is now the only reality there is. And therefore, magically, that should then our thirst should be quenched by special relationships, by materiality, by things, by animal existence, and all this. This is magical belief, magical thinking. Doesn't work. But we just keep thinking it, we just believe in it. Yeah, it works. That somehow it's going to work. It's not the case. Again, everything that we see is just a mere appearances. Let's say you killed the body of Jesus. Okay, how did that then cause an imperfection in pure spaciousness? This is the question. How does the appearance or disappearance of any appearance, how does that cause an imperfection in pure spaciousness? Whether pure spaciousness appears empty or whether it appears full, what's the difference? Pure spaciousness is here's a mouse, and it's here now. Now it's over here, and now we take it out of the frame. Pure spaciousness the same? Isn't it always the same? Isn't it unchanging? Isn't it unchangeable? So how can we kill it? How can we say we kill it? Using a symbol, say, okay, this symbol symbolizes pure spaciousness. Now we killed this symbol, and so that killed pure spaciousness. No, that's magic. Magic uses symbols. Manipulates symbols and then claims that somehow that's affected the reality the symbol arbitrarily stands for. And the pagan mindset has been using this for forever. Been using magical thinking from the beginning. It's not just this situation we're discussing, but it's actually many others too. Similar, very similar situations. Different religions, different places. Scapegoat, sacrificial atonement, scapegoating. You know, all these myths that we arise that seem like, aha, this is a way to solve our problem. Because we our creativity is so strong that we simply can't seem to recognize or believe that we have not been able to cause a problem with reality. We're so sure that we somehow created a problem for reality that actually we discovered it, you know. But our creativity makes it seem that there's definitely a problem. So the notion that the remedy is to recognize that there is no problem, we reject that almost, you know, without even thinking. Which is why when those who come to tell us this truth, we say, oh, that's nonsense. What are you talking about? That's unbelievable. Belief always has to do with a problem. So reality is unbelievable. That's right. We say it's unbelievable that there couldn't be any problem with reality. That's totally unbelievable. Correct. Because belief is always a belief in a problem. Now, we can turn belief around and say that the problem is that there isn't any problem, and we need then to gradually accept the fact that there isn't any problem. So we can still hold on to belief. We don't have to get rid of belief. We can just say, okay, I believe that the problem I really have is that there is no problem, and I need to gradually get used to this truth of this, and then ultimately I'll set down belief altogether, because I will know that there isn't any problem with reality. In fact, there can never be. What thing excludes pure spaciousness? Everything is occupying space, spaciousness. There's spaciousness to all. And just, for instance, let's talk about minerals or something, gemstones. And gemstones the same size, and then we put different gemstones in the same place. Diamonds, opals, rubies, sapphires, on and on and on. And gold, even gold, for instance. It's not a gem, but gold. And the spaciousness that these gemstones occupy is the same spaciousness. Whatever happens to appear in it, it doesn't change the fact that this gem is occupying, so to speak. It has this area of spaciousness where it is, and it's the same where out, you know, it's the same everywhere. It's not separate from it. Spaciousness doesn't stop at the edge of a diamond, which is the pagan belief that it does, is why there's so many people wearing diamond rings and diamond necklaces and gems. That's a pagan, very pagan thing to do. Jewelry, it's saying, hey, you know, this represents spaciousness stopping. I'm able to stop spaciousness. I'm separate from it. You know, so I've been able to establish the problematical nature of reality, and it's like that, but it's not true. A diamond and a piece of mud occupy the very same spaciousness, pure spaciousness, which is just one. There's no seams to it. There are no seams to it. It doesn't start here and end here. It doesn't change and or variate at all. I remember Ramana Maharshi said something about someone dug a hole and said, look, there's space now. There's space in the hole. And Ramana says there was already space there. The spaciousness was already there, whether you dug a hole or not. And I suddenly said, wow, that is true. That matter doesn't occlude pure spaciousness at all. Everything is already floating in pure spaciousness, already complete, floating in the same spaciousness. Sameness. Now, seeing this quenches our thirst. All is divine. All is already divine. This is where we must go to quench this craving that we have. Not towards kissing bodies, you know, a special relationship. That's the wrong place to go for it. And of course, you can see in the attitudes of the world what the world believes in is completely obvious. Is the world now is so much of the world is just believing like this is where you go for it, so you got to go for it here, and so come on, go for it, you know, this attitude. Whereas in more religious societies that had more of a understanding, like, no, that's not it, there's something else where we have to find it. The way that they acted and dressed and everything, they comported themselves in modesty, saying basically, this isn't it, bodies aren't it at all. So, no go for it at all. There's no go for it in this here whatsoever. And then that helps everybody focus on, well, where do we need to look for this? Now, in the times that I've had a little glimpses of success, it has had to do with looking at the world more in terms of spaciousness, pure spaciousness, as the primary, instead of what people are doing, what's the activity, instead of activity, and instead of the qualities and the activities and the attractiveness of everything, more or less this way, the reactions, interactions, and all of this, instead of that being primary, I shifted to saying that the beingness is primary. The beingness in pure spaciousness, that is the primary quality of everything. And it's that, emphasizing that, which then I was able to easily begin to experience what you would call a vision of oneness, vision of sameness. Now, why I haven't done more of that is because probably the success I got was so tremendous, so amazing. I was maybe startled by it for sure, and I wondered, is this it? It's like, what? Suddenly, the whole world seems completely blessed. Effortlessly blessed. Inherently blessed. I don't need to do anything. It's already completely blessed. I don't need to sacrifice anything. I don't need atonement, sacrificial atonement, or anything. And you just say, what? This is quite amazing. So maybe that's why it's let me dial this down a little bit. It's just the continuity factor what crapped up. And I said, well, wait a minute. This is, but we're told that this it's that simple, actually. But there again, the world is so busy trying to quench its thirst that we feel if we don't keep busy that way, that somehow our thirst is not going to be quenched. And so we have this conflict. Say, wait a minute, it seemed like my thirst was just quenched there for a moment there. And they say, yeah, but that's only for a moment. Reality's not perfect, so it was imperfectly quenched. I said, well, wait a minute. Maybe leaving that awareness of pure spaciousness, maybe that was what brought about the lack of quenchment. And the world says, no, you left because that's everything changes. I said, no, wait a minute. How can that pure spaciousness change? How can the quality of that change? That doesn't quite add up. So I say, no, wait a minute. So I've been evaluating this, within my psyche, evaluating this. Who's telling the truth? Is it the world when it's magical belief, believing that reality's flawed? Or is it the demand that they're saying, well, it will be flawed, or it must be flawed, because that's what we want. And they say, if you don't believe that we get what we want, then your thirst can never be quenched. And I say, well, we can never get what we want if we claim that we can imprison ourselves. The sneeze is trying to build up here. Wow, okay. Say, I'll just stop it. So we're told, well, if it's perfect, that means we don't get what we want. And I say, wait. Am I right back at this spot now? Yeah, we're not going to struggle with it too much. Because it's a continuity issue, right? The continuity fear arises, and we play this card like we always play this card, because it's a very effective card to stall us out. So we won't struggle to try to explain that. We already have explained that numerous times in the video. But see how it arises again when we get a little bit nervous. I don't struggle with that, just full stop. Don't struggle. Getting intense tingling in my nose, just intense. Wow. Tense reactions. There's itching at my forehead now. My face is getting all these reactions. Temptation to react and scratch it is so intense. But again, hands to hands. It's part of our discipline. So you just say, no matter what, I'm not scratching it. So that's it. And my right brow area, the right side of the nose going up towards my brow, is intense itching and tingling and sensation. More reactions are now playing over the surface of the face. Wow. This means that we've certainly played upon some very important areas. And it's almost like you swear there must be a bug walking on you or something. You know, it just has to be something there. So that's why you try to get rid of it. There's nothing there. These are just sensations. Which brings to mind that old snake and rope motif of you feel this and you think there's a rope there, but you feel these sensations. You think it must be a snake moving there. You know, it has to be something there. And there isn't. There's nothing there. Just sensations. That mantra keeps going. Still craving your kiss, but your could be YORE, right? It means history. Still craving to continue on with the past, what we've done before. Still craving to continue on with what we've done before. This is the deflation. Still craving to continue on with what we've done before. And we're saying, no, we don't have that craving anymore. We're evaporating that craving. We're craving to see the oneness, the sameness, vision of sameness, vision of oneness. That is untouched by any sort of density, factors of supposed density. From the standpoint of pure spaciousness, there's no density at all. Being zero-dimensional, there's no density factor at play. Everything is equally abiding in pure spaciousness. You can't even say floating because it's the same everywhere. Everything is already, you know, perfectly abiding in pure spaciousness. There's no separation at all. There can never be. Now, the way to keep the past from lingering on is to realize there's never been any past in the way that we're looking at it. As if relationships have somehow changed with God, as if something has happened. Nothing's ever happened. So from that standpoint, from the standpoint of pure spaciousness, nothing's ever happened. There isn't any past. So how can the past linger on? It was never here. Our fantasy that something has happened must come to an end. It's just a fantasy that we keep projecting on what was taking place. Now, various appearances have arisen and fallen, risen and fallen, arising, subsiding, rising, and subsiding, but nothing's ever happened in terms of ground of being at all. Nothing ever happens in that way. So the idea that somehow we are accomplishing something in this world is simply not true. But the more we believe that belief is why all the appearances have had, that's why they've arisen and played out in the way that they've played out, is because we believe that something needs to be accomplished, something can be accomplished, something needs to be accomplished. Otherwise, the arising would just be of saints. And the subsidence of the body of the saints would not affect the saints at all, actually. That would be what we'd look back on. And we probably wouldn't even be here right now as far as pretending to appear as a body, because we already realized that we don't need to seek the quenching of our thirst through time, the illusion, mirage of time, space, process, and form. It's like we're trying to quench our thirst with a mirage of a lake. And we keep trying to find a way to get to that lake and drink it, and we can't. And we say, well, we know the lake is there, you know, it's obvious, we just haven't figured it out yet. No, it's a mirage. How can we quench our thirst with a mirage of a lake? That's what we're trying to do. And so someone says, I have the mirage of water here. And then they say, I have it too. Here, let's drink. And we're drinking. Oh, we feel so much better. But yet then later on, it's like, well, I still feel thirsty. Maybe, you know, maybe you didn't give me enough water or something. And we get angry and upset. It's all a mirage. The idea that there's tree spaciousness and plant spaciousness and stone spaciousness and everything has its own spaciousness is completely false. So as long as we think we're getting spaciousness from, you know, food spacious, I'm eating this food and that's going to quench my thirst, it's not true. As long as we keep the person spaciousness, you know, that person has their own spaciousness. their own separate spaciousness. This is the delusion that we have. As soon as that delusion is dispelled, then you might say, you know, we're enlightened, no longer deluded. Philosophically, you could say there's no thing in itself. Meaning that the space that it occupies is not tree spaciousness. People call it, you know, pure consciousness, pure awareness, pure spaciousness. It's all the same. The spaciousness that tree occupies is pure spaciousness. It's not tree spaciousness. So you might say that we lose sight of God coming into this world with, actually, prior to that too, I mean, but we just use this as an example, coming into the world. We don't see God. We see everything in it as if it was a thing in itself, having its own quality of spaciousness, as if the appearance of things, the matter, supposed matter of it, which is just, you know, hologram, somehow taints the pure spaciousness, touches it, and the key is to realize it doesn't touch it. Nothing, no appearance touches that which it appears in, the pure spaciousness that it appears in. It doesn't taint it. Doesn't affect it. And of course, if we cut down a tree, we say, "Oh my gosh, I just altered the tree spaciousness." You know, and we get frightened. We think, "Wow, spaciousness really is affected by all this." This perspective makes you very frightened. And it's just this little shift in perspective that is all we really truly need. And allowing this to bubble up in the world here is, there's a lot of resistance in the world to this. And yet, the world actually has no power that it claims. It claims it has some power, it must be defeated. There's no thing in itself here that has any power that needs to be defeated. So it's this realization that nothing needs to be defeated. Nothing needs to be overcome. The concrete has no more claim on pure spaciousness as air has a claim on pure spaciousness. There's no difference at all. From the standpoint of pure spaciousness, there's no difference at all between air and lead. Getting a call here. Ah, okay. I may have to, I don't know why I'm getting this call, but why don't you step aside for just a moment and just use this opportunity to contemplate on what's been said and the wow of it, and let it just sink in. Just have a quiet time here for one moment here. All right, little emergency there. Now, the hope is that saying this, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, will enable us to see this vision of pure spaciousness, to see the world, see everything as this way, which certainly redefines the world. I mean, we would not see the world the way others see it at all. Even though it will seem to be the same world, yet, you know, there's no thing in itself anywhere at all. Whereas we believe the world is a place where there's all these things in itself, and there's all these differences. We wouldn't see that differenceness in that way at all. We say everything's equally abiding in pure spaciousness. There's no difference at all to be found in this way, whereas others would think that everything is different. Everything has a thing in itself quality, and it's all when that we're changing the very nature of pure spaciousness continuously here, that's being continuously evolving and changing, and that we need to have our attention in this world in order to know how reality is evolving. And that if we're not here in this world, we're going to not be aware of reality, how it's evolving. We believe that reality is evolving. Okay, this is not true. And we think that the evolution of reality is taking place in this world, that we're in a very central place, like we have a front row seat in the evolution of reality, evolution of consciousness taking place here. And so suddenly we feel like, I lost my front row seat. You know, I'm not going to be aware of how reality evolves. Reality doesn't evolve. It doesn't evolve at all. The ground of being does not evolve. Reality is not an evolutionary process. There's no process at all to reality. It's just absolute freedom of experiencing. So when we say, "Oh, I lost the world," that's okay. What you mean is you lost the notion that reality is somehow changing and evolving. That's okay, because it's not. It's a misperception, misinterpretation, intentional on our part. If we interpret it as if we've just suddenly lost sight of what's going on in the world, then of course we'll get frightened. We say, "Hey, I really love this, but I've got to get back to reality," we think. You see, as long as we think that reality is something that's evolving, then when we have this vision of pure spaciousness, we'll feel like, "Well, I can't linger here," because I got to get back to reality. It's really getting back to unreality, or self-delusion, is thinking there's a evolving world taking place. There's a dance of appearances, but reality is untouched by appearances, and it's never changed. It's not changeable. Pure spaciousness isn't changeable. That's why Jesus says that you can be enlightened here in the world as long as you don't value anything of this world. Meaning, believe that something's happening here, that something's happening to reality. That somehow you need something to happen to complete what you are, what reality is. That reality needs something to happen. This is not true. Full stop in the wow is now I know this shift can take place. This happened to me several times. Where I was just simply willing to do it. And then I guess there was a sort of a counter reaction of saying, are you sure that's it? Because you don't want to miss out on all the great changes that are taking place. But is any change happening to pure spaciousness? No. So I don't really have to worry about, am I missing something? Am I unhip? You know, am I missing out? Am I deprived? Am I not, you know, getting my thirst quenched? The quenching of the thirst comes from seeing that there's no way that you can be thirsty, actually. All thirst itself is the mirage. Thirst itself is the mirage. Thirst itself is the imaginary problem. Craving itself is the imaginary problem. The answer to quench the craving is to realize that there is no craving. No craving anywhere. No actual craving anywhere. Because everyone is equally abiding in pure spaciousness. Always, everywhere. So it's all the same everywhere. So it can never be a craving arising, never be a thirst arise. Like I have a thirst for knowledge. I have a thirst for, it's incomplete. You know, I have a thirst to complete something. There's no such condition. That's an imaginary condition. So the way to quench our thirst is to realize that we don't have any thirst. It's impossible to have a thirst. So we just rest a little bit with this recognition. So if we can tie this together and say, a vision of pure spaciousness, vision of sameness, vision of oneness, means there isn't any thirst. No one has any real thirst at all. and then recognize that this is what everyone has to be brought to. So don't leave it. Just stay with it. That certainly helps that people come to it. If you leave it, then people will come to you and say, well, where is it? And say, well, I left it. Well, that doesn't help them. Left it. Don't know where it is. It's everywhereness. You know, how do you re-find everywhereness? Well, you stop imagining that it could be anywhere, that it could be somewhere. Stop imagining that a thirst is possible. Stop imagining that a craving is possible. So this is a wow moment. I'm experiencing it. This has helped greatly. So we just full stop in the wow. So how do we defeat all those demons of craving that Mara, the Buddha experienced, you know, all these cravings trying to arise? They realize that they don't exist. They cannot exist. There's no such thing as any real craving. It's impossible. It's our false way of looking at the reality that gives rise to these cravings, but they're not true cravings at all. The solution is to realize that cravings cannot exist. Not to say that they're real and then quench the craving, but to recognize they cannot exist at all. It's impossible. Ultimately, there's nothing that can crave in the first place. There's no thing in itselfness. There's only the allness. Only the allness. So what is it that can crave? This little song that I was singing, still craving, you know, it wouldn't shut up until I just made this turnaround here, and then that shut it up. It's impossible to crave. Reality cannot crave. There cannot be any cravings. So the belief in cravings is a belief that reality has a problem. Reality is fundamentally changed from what it actually is. So there can't be a lack of peace of mind. There cannot be a disturbed mind. That's all an illusion. There cannot be a craving mind. That's an illusion of a mind. It's not mind at all. Mind is not craving. So we just let this sink in, full stop in the wow. Just let it sink in. I don't know, you know, what to think is such a dramatic turnaround. Again, full stop in the wow. Don't try to figure out how it's going to work out in the future or something. Just let it just say, hey, let it sink in. Let it sink in, let it sink in. Don't try to do anything about it. Don't try to do anything with it. It's like you get a new bicycle. Just look at the bike. Don't try to ride it right now. Get a new car. Don't try to drive it. Just say, wow, there's a new car in my driveway. Don't start imagining, well, how's it going to be to drive this car? Start imagining that. No, just stop, full stop. Say, no, just there's a new car in my driveway, and just deal with that fact. There's a new idea in our mind, so to speak, now, that craving's impossible. That's a lot better than sacrificial atonement, saying, let's project our cravings onto a scapegoat, kill the scapegoat. That, you know, that's saying cravings are real, but we can get rid of them. But what we're saying here is cravings are not real. They're unreal. There's no reality to cravings at all. It's impossible that there be any cravings in reality. So we don't make illusions real in order to defeat them. This is a magical belief. Don't try to make illusions real in order to then defeat them. Oh, here comes the... Defeat me there, you see? Wow, it caught me, tricked me there, very tricky. It snuck up on me in a certain way. My attention got distracted, that sneeze snuck up on me. I didn't notice the way it was trying to sneak up was a trickier way than before. Isn't that amazing? How... even something like a sneeze has intelligence, and it found a way to get around my stopping of it. And I did have some warning. What happened was, it seemed like first the thought was, oh, there hasn't been any sneezing, no irritation coming up recently. As soon as I thought that, some irritation arose. And I said, oh, I just said there wouldn't be any. And then suddenly it stopped. And I said, oh, okay. See, there really isn't any. And then suddenly it came on again, like, real strong like that. So it was, you know, trying to outfox me. And now that little song is coming back. You see how clever the defenses are. It's trying to distract me. The sneeze is trying to distract me off of the clarity of the full stop. This little song, a craving, still craving your kiss, still craving. I'm still craving. I couldn't get rid of it until I realized that craving's impossible. As soon as I saw that, it stopped. Gone. Then this sneeze tricked me. This irritation tricked me. And as soon as that happened, that little song came back. See, that little song has tricks, doesn't it? Our belief in craving has tricks and defends itself. When we say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, we're saying, well, we don't have any craving. I'm not a body. There are no bodies, actually. They're only appearances. So this defenses are now trying to reassert themselves, you see. So we push them aside for a moment, and now they're coming back. So go back to, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. When you cannot do this intense spiritual practice of looking very carefully here, and you're going about your waking sleep, keep saying this, I am not a body, I am free, and prevent these defenses from gaining momentum. It pushes them aside, Do not allow your clarity to be deflated. We need this bubble of recognition in the world so that we can have the wow placed in its proper perspective context here, the wow, like wow. We're craving recognition. Ultimately, the recognition is that we can't crave at all because we are inescapably what we are. We can never not be aware of what we are, actually. And so we can't truly crave what we are. It's a mirage, an illusion of craving. But this is a wow because of the continuity fear. This is a wow. So the wow needs to be put on that. Instead of trying to satisfy our cravings, the wow needs to be put on ultimately to recognize that it's impossible for us to crave. This is where the wow needs to be placed. Now the saints have this quality of seeming to not have any craving at all. They seem free of that free of the torments of craving, right? And this is a huge wow for us. This is where the wow needs to be. It's like, wow. Now, we may misinterpret initially, say, wow, somehow the cravings have been fulfilled or something. But more than that, we gradually get to hear that they realize that cravings are impossible. The mind cannot truly crave at all. So it's more of a realization than it is a fulfillment of a craving. But anyway, the wow has to be on that instead of on trying to fulfill our cravings through materiality, secular, humanistic materialism is the false religion. It's very much a false religion. Traditional religious terminology, we call it the Antichrist. Antichrist, absolutely. The Luciferians, who are telling us they know how to satisfy our cravings. They have the way to satisfy our cravings. And the spiritual truth will tell us that we don't have any cravings at all. We don't have any true cravings. It's impossible. So the notion that we have to spend all this time and effort trying to satisfy our cravings is delusional. We can't even have this craving to know who I am. That's also delusional. And why do we have these delusions? Because we wanted to claim that reality had a problem. To say that we can have a craving to know what we are means that reality has a problem. How could there be this craving to know what we are in reality? All reality knows all reality. There can't possibly be a craving to know reality. So we will continue here to put our attention on this, put our wow, the attention and then the wow on the truth. Truth removes the craving by recognizing that the craving is impossible. The snake is removed from the rope by realizing that this snake is impossible. The snake of craving is impossible. So it can't be there. We only had a desire to claim that there's this problem, so we projected its desire on the rope, but the snake was never there, actually. It was only our desire that there be a problem with reality. But reality was never touched by our attempt to establish a problem. It was never touched by it. So there's no reason to extricate the snake from the rope. It was never entangled with the rope. Our identity, our true identity, has never been entangled with false identity. It's never been entangled with it at all. False belief. So we just keep working at this and we will certainly succeed. But nothing succeeds like familiarity. And this is the key. So don't get upset if you haven't succeeded intellectually. You say, I just can't get it. But familiarity and expectation are along for the ride, you see. And once they say, hey, yeah, this is what I expect, this is what I'm familiar with, then problem solved. Problem solved once that takes place. All right. So that's enough for this one. And perhaps I'll do another one if I can. Okay, very great. That's it.